This is a meme, and in 2006 it irrevocably changed the games industry. And this is a $21,000 ship being sold for an unreleased game called Star Atlas. But how did Horse Armour lead to this? When Bethesda released a $2.50 Horse Armour for Oblivion, it sent shockwaves through the gaming community. It might seem strange today, but barely 15 years ago, the idea of paying money for in-game cosmetics was preposterous. More than that, it was seen as a greedy, money-grabbing tactic. And as to be expected, gamers moaned, they grumbled, and they complained. Other gamers laughed and joked about it. Others still decided they would never, ever purchase such a useless virtual item. Most agreed that Bethesda should be very ashamed of themselves. Yet, here we are, around 1.5 decades later, and no one even blinks at the idea of paying real-world money for virtual cosmetic items. In fact, it's often an expected part of many games. So, what changed? Well, this is a question that is actually very easy to answer, but it's also one that has a convoluted history. And to be honest, I did think about going on a grand tour of that history, but it feels beyond the scope of this video and somewhat redundant, as many of you are more than aware of the existence of paid DLC. So let's jump straight to the bottom line. What is the bottom line? Well, people's concept of value underwent a dramatic shift. In 2006, asking $2.50 for horse armor was viewed as meme-level stupidity. Yet here, in 2021, many people are more than happy to pay £6 or significantly more for a Warframe skin. It's now a standard practice then that digital assets, cosmetic items, are a regular part of gaming, and some of them are priced very high indeed. A sad story then, but one that wouldn't be so sad if cosmetics is where it all ended. However, cosmetics eventually laid the path towards paid gameplay advantages, and thus pay-to-win was born. Pay-to-win is now everywhere. In fact, it's so ubiquitous that sometimes it can be a little hard to even notice it exists. So to start with then, let's define pay-to-win. Urban Dictionary defines pay-to-win as games that let you buy better gear or make better items than everyone else at a faster rate, and then makes the game largely unbalanced even for people who have skill in the game without paying. Urban Dictionary also has the following definition: any game policy where specific content needed to win is locked behind paywalls, forcing people to pay in order to access said content, while none can gain access to the content through other in-game methods such as combat, trading, etc. So clearly, these are two very, very different definitions. For my purposes then, I'm going to go with the following. Pay to win is using real-world money to gain an in-game advantage. There, simple. Now, this is something that very much affects our hobby as space gamers. In fact, I'd go as far to say most of these big space titles, to varying degrees, contain pay-to-win aspects. Star Citizen is an obvious one to look at. The game is crowdfund-driven via pledges on its pledge store. Over the years, CIG have done some amazing work at creating the concept of value within Star Citizen. Much of that has been based around the perceived value of its ships. Taking a leaf out of the marketing from high-end sports cars and luxury yachts, CIG very much portray their virtual ships as high-ticket value items. Whilst anyone can get in on the ground floor of Star Citizen with a $45 plus tax purchase, the ability to buy significant in-game advantages and skip progression steps with real-world money is most certainly pay to win. Yes, all of these ships are available through gameplay means, or at least will be when they're added to the game, but real-world money instantly overrides that. CIG's large-scope plans for future Star Citizen gameplay shows where the pay-to-win advantages become front and center. Players with the best exploration ship will explore faster, reaching new locations first. Pioneer and land claim beacon owners can grab highly valued land before other players. Those that have stockpiled UEC and spare game accounts can quickly crew up with NPCs to run their large multi-crew ships. Now, Elite Dangerous is perhaps a less obvious example. Much of the perceived value in Elite is based on time. That is to say, how long it takes to achieve any specific goal. A secondary value is found in what golds unlock. A better ship, or a better weapon, for example. So the first major expansion for Elite, 2015's Horizons, added a whole range of new unlocks in the form of engineering in its June 2016 update. That is, the ability to access further ship and weapon enhancements via gameplay loops. Engineering only existed in Horizons, a paid expansion. The only way to access engineering was to pay for Horizons. A paid advantage is a paid advantage, even if it's part of an expansion that most, if not all, players are expected to purchase at some point. Horizons was paid to win because of engineering. However, in 2020, that pay to win advantage was effectively removed when Horizons was bundled for free for all owners of Elite Dangerous, and everyone now had access to engineering. EVE Online, meanwhile, has had a pay to win features for an extremely long time. Here, players can use real world money to purchase Plex, a form of in-game currency. This Plex can in turn be exchanged for yet another in-game currency, credits. Credits can be used to purchase just about anything. Essentially, if you have enough real-world money to put into EVE, you will be able to buy more or less anything in the game. Distinctly, pay to win then. So, using my definition, all of these games are clearly pay to win in one way or another. But pay to win, really, is it the greatest evil that many gamers believe it to be? Well, that really comes down to the individual game. Is the game world balanced? Does it offer something for everyone? Is it fun? More importantly, does the game deliver on its perceived value for money? After all, if a person is happy with their extremely expensive virtual spaceship in Star Citizen, is anyone really getting hurt? Quite naturally, everyone is going to draw the line in a different place as to where they feel pay to win is a problem. Some people will be far more tolerant than others. And ultimately, I think we can all agree that the practice does fund our hobby of space games. After all, studios can't make games for free, right? And the purchase of price of a title is often not enough on its own to maintain a live surface world. However, there's always the argument of just how much money is actually needed. Now, if we do step back, there's always a broader picture to look at as well. Back in 2006, with the release of Oblivion's Horse Armour, more than a few people predicted that the concept of paid DLC would be a slippery slope. That companies would gradually find more and more ways to monetize gaming, until monetization becomes synonymous with gaming. To be fair, those people weren't too far wrong. Yet here, in 2021, plenty of people are once again making the claims that existing monetization models are a slippery slope. Star Citizen is, rightly or wrongly, often used as an example of funding a game through digital sales before it is even released. But how much of a slippery slope could this possibly be? Well, enter Star Atlas. Star Atlas is a space game with truly massive ambitions. You can see the game's website on the screen right now. The website also contains a massive in-depth white paper detailing what the game is all about. So, what is it? Well, Star Atlas apparently is going to be a grand strategy space game within which players can trade, conquer, and explore. The game will feature role-playing with various features allowing players to establish in-game careers. Most importantly, perhaps, Star Atlas will feature first-personal, manually piloted spaceships. Interestingly, the game will be built upon blockchain technology and also will use Unreal 5. Now, the funding for Star Atlas is where things get truly interesting. Currently, the game is in Phase 1. This is where the Star Atlas marketplace has been opened, and this allows players to buy and sell digital non-fungible token assets. These assets will be playable at a later point when the game eventually releases. Phase 2 opens up a browser-based minigame, which the developers themselves class as a minimum viable product version of Star Atlas. In-game assets will be able to be utilized in the minigame. Now, Phase 3 moves on to the Shipyard module, and this will allow players to view their in-game assets, but is limited to a single shipyard as the playable area. Phase 4 is the final pre-sale beta, whilst Phase 5 goes into release territory. Now, there's no dates on any of this aside from, I believe, Phase 2, the minigame, which should be happening any time now. So the whole theme of Star Atlas is pretty complex and certainly beyond the scope of this video, but it is a subject that I want to visit in a future video. But right now, how is it relevant to this video? Well, in terms of pay to win and purchasing digital assets, it seems that so far Star Atlas is very successful. As of the 8th of September, according to the Game Zone website, it has already generated $41 million of sales of NFTs related to the project. A brief look at the current Star Atlas marketplace explains how this money has been raised. Many items are selling for hundreds and in some cases thousands of dollars. Now, it's clear at this point that Star Atlas is charting a new territory for gaming, or perhaps more to the point, charting new territory on how to extract money from game players. To put it mildly, it's going to be very interesting to see where this one goes. Star Atlas isn't alone with this ambition. Another title is Earth 2, which is aiming to create a duplicate of Earth and sell digital property rights and land claims, among many other things. Both Earth 2 and Star Atlas, for more details on those, do check out the links in the video description. So then, are these games the future of pay to win? Do you feel this is where digital transactions are ultimately heading? Or is this perhaps a step too far and doomed to failure? Do let me know your thoughts in the comment section below, I'd love to hear from you. As always, thanks for watching, and I'll catch you guys and girls next time.